Recorded Books presents Weasel by Cynthia DeFelice, narrated by Jeff Woodman.
Chapter 1. The State of Ohio, 1839. The dogs were dozing in their usual places by the fire when the knock came. My sister Molly and I jumped. Who could be stopping at our cabin, so deep in the woods, so far from town, so late at night? Pa, I thought. But no, Pa wouldn't knock. He'd come right through the door, white teeth smiling through his dark whiskers, brown eyes dancing, and say, "I'm back. Who's got a hug for me?" And I would run and knock, knock, knock. Duffy and Winston were fully roused by then and began barking wildly. They jumped at the cabin door, sniffing and whining. Molly and I joined them.
"Who's there?" called Molly.
No one answered. But again, knock, knock. I opened the door a few inches and peered into the darkness. A man stood in the shadows, back a ways from the cabin. I knew it was a man, but he made me think of a wild creature. He was shy of the cabin and the light from the doorway. I had the feeling he might turn and run, like an animal that senses danger. He was dressed like no white man I had ever seen, in tattered clothing and what looked like animal skins. I could make out a tall hat and long, tangled hair. His beard was dark, and so were his eyes, which were looking right into mine. The dogs stopped barking and stood quietly, staring at the stranger. We stared too, waiting for him to speak. Finally, Molly said,
"Who are you? What do you want?"
Without saying a word, the man reached into the leather pouch that hung over his shoulder. He found something and held it out in his hand with his palm open. It gleamed shiny and golden. Molly took it and held it up in the lantern light. She gasped.
"Mama's locket," I cried.
Chapter 2.
Mama's locket. Pa had given it to her the day they were married. It was real gold and shaped like a heart. Mama had worn it every day. Inside was a tiny lock of Pa's hair, a bit of Molly's and some of mine, too.
"So you'll always be with me, wherever I go," Mama used to say. On the day Mama died of the fever, Pa cut a lock of her hair and placed it in the locket. He put that locket on under his shirt, and he never took it off, not even for washing up. If this man had Mama's locket, he must have seen Pa. Maybe he knew where Pa was right now. Maybe...
"Where did you get this?"
Molly asked, and she sounded scared. I figured she was thinking the same thing I was. Pa would never take off the locket unless he had a good reason, or unless someone made him take it off. But who? And why?
"Where's our Pa?"
I shouted. My voice seemed strange to me. Still, the man stood silent. Then slowly, he crooked his finger at us and beckoned.
"He wants us to go with him," I exclaimed.
"To Papa," said Molly, but her voice faded to a whisper. Molly and I looked at each other for a long moment. 6 days before, our Pa had gone out hunting.
"I'll be back in a few hours with something for supper," he had said,
but he hadn't come back. The hours had turned into days, long days filled with listening and looking for Pa. Being as I was 11 years old and Molly 9, we knew how to do most everything around the farm. I chopped wood and kept the fire going. Molly made bread and stew. We fed the animals, we fetched the water, we did everything we knew to keep things right. And we waited. That was the worst part. No matter what else we were doing, we were waiting. "He'll be back tomorrow," I'd say to Molly as we ate our supper.
"He probably got so much meat he can hardly carry it all,"
Molly would say.
but we didn't really believe it, and after a few days we ran out of things to say. We didn't dare say what we were both thinking. Something must have happened to Pa. Then, that night, as we were eating our stew, Molly had begun to cry softly. I had wanted to cry too, but I couldn't. Pa had said to me, "Take care of things while I'm gone, Nathan. You're the oldest, and you're the man of the house when I'm away." Pa had smiled as he spoke, but I knew he meant what he said. I kept saying the words over and over to myself, "The man of the house." But Pa was the man of the house. What would Pa do? It didn't help to think about that. It only got me tangled up and confused, because if Pa was here, everything would be all right. I turned to the stranger. "Where do you want to take us?" I asked. Again, no answer, just the beckoning hand. Molly looked at me and shrugged. "Why won't he talk to us?" she whispered. "I don't know," I said. "Maybe he can't. Maybe he can't even hear us." "But he must know where Papa is. He has Mama's locket," Molly said. There was a silence while we both thought about what to do. "He's so strange, Nathan," Molly said. I looked again at the man standing in the shadows. He was strange, but I had a feeling about him. Maybe he had hurt Pa and taken the locket, but I didn't think so. An idea came upon me all of a sudden. Maybe Pa sent the locket as a sign to us. "Molly, I think we should go with him," I said. "It's the only way we'll find out what happened to Pa. We know he'd have come home if he could. What if he needs our help? He could have sent the locket so we'd know to come. And, well, seems like anything's better than waiting here, not knowing." I thought about how she had clung to the dogs the last few days for comfort. "We can take Duffy and Wynn with us," I added. Molly looked at the stranger again, then looked at me and nodded. "You're right, Nathan. Anything's better than just sitting here waiting. Let's go. I'll get us some warm clothes," she said, and turned back inside. I called into the shadows, "Please wait. We need to get some supplies." There was no answer. Inside, I gathered food and put it in my pack. Molly added warm clothing, then said, "I'll bring this, too." She was holding Mama's medicine bag. Slowly, I nodded, but I didn't like to think that we would need it. I put out the fire and took the kettle off the hook where it hung. I poured a cup of the strong herb tea Molly had made, the kind Pa liked, and took it out to the stranger. The man held the cup awkwardly with two hands and gulped. When he handed it back, he reached up and touched me, just for a moment, on the shoulder. Then he turned and started into the woods. "Molly!" I called. Molly, Duffy, and Wynn came running out of the darkened cabin, and off we went to find Pa. We hoped. Chapter 3. The man slipped through the forest like a shadow. At first, he moved so quickly and quietly that I was sure we would be left behind. Then he slowed his pace to match ours as we stumbled through the darkness, tripping over roots, our clothing catching in the branches. Duffy and Wynn moved along easily, and after a while, when Molly and I got used to the darkness, we moved faster too. Once I fell, and a strong arm caught and held me until I got my balance. Later, I heard Molly stumble and cry out, then whisper, "Thank you." In the beginning, I tried to keep track of where we were going, but soon I gave it up. The twisted paths weren't familiar to me, and it took almost all of my concentration just to stay on my feet and keep up. I kept an eye on the bright star in the north and reckoned we were traveling due west. My thoughts were racing around and around in my head, but going nowhere, like when Duffy and Wynn chased their tails, I thought. One minute, I'd think about seeing Pa again, and I'd feel real good. Then I'd think, you're acting like a darn fool. Heading out in the middle of the night to follow a complete stranger. And I'd start to feel scared. The man has Mama's locket, I argued with myself. That means Pa sent him for us. Doesn't it? Yes. I wasn't sure if I'd cried aloud or not. We kept on. I felt near worn out from the worrying and the walking. Molly began to fall behind, and I held onto her arm and tried to think of something that would make her feel hopeful. I reckon we're getting close to Pa now, I said. Molly nodded and smiled, but said nothing. We came to a narrow ledge, and I had to let go of Molly's arm to walk single file. On our left rose the sheer wall of a steep mountain cliff. The land dropped off real sharp to the right, and below us flowed the big river, the one the Shawnee Indians called the Big Turkey River, and we called the Ohio. The sun was coming up, and its tender light was shining through the trees and touching the rock cliff where we stood. The river looked like it was on fire, all pink and orange and bright. Mama always said things seem better in the morning. I could feel my spirits rising with the sun. In the dawn light, I saw Molly's face, pale with tiredness. Looking ahead for our leader, I saw that the stranger, too, had stopped and was watching the world turn from night to day. Something about the way he stood kept me from speaking. It's almost as if he's praying, I thought. Then the man turned to us and slowly nodded. It seemed like a greeting and then some, like he was saying something about the sun coming up and how good it was. I nodded in return. Good morning, sir, I said. The night had passed in almost complete silence, and it felt queer to be speaking now. I continued uncertainly. Please, could we stop for a spell? We brought a bit of food. We'd be proud if you'd share it with us. I waited, not knowing if the man would answer or even hear. It would feel good to rest, sir, said Molly. She added shyly, you must be tired, too. The stranger pointed ahead to a wider spot on the trail. Molly and I looked at each other with relief. We followed and watched our companion sit down among the rocks and leaves. As soon as he was still, he seemed to blend in with his surroundings. Awkwardly, we sat down too, and the dog settled in close as Molly broke the bread and I cut pieces from the chunk of venison I had put in the pack. The man took the food we offered with another sober nod. The pale morning light gave us our first good look at him. I knew it wasn't polite to stare at folks, but still, I couldn't take my eyes off him. I'd seen a few Shawnees, the Indians who used to live in these parts, before they were all driven off. This man looked like one of them, except he was a white man, not an Indian. He wore cloth trousers, like Pa's, but his shirt, leggings, and moccasins were fashioned of buckskin, and so was the pouch that hung around his neck. The moccasins were all prettied up with beadwork, and some things that looked like they might be the stickers off a porcupine's back. Everything he wore appeared to be held together with strips of hide, some rawhide, and some with the fur left on. Around his neck were necklaces, one of rawhide strung with the teeth and claws of animals, and one of threaded blue glass beads. His hair was long, and held on either side of his head with strips of cloth. He wore a tall black hat, like I had seen in a picture of Andrew Jackson when he was the president. It was pulled down low over his ears and eyes. With the hat, and the way he sat so straight and looked so serious, he was pretty near as dignified as Mr. Jackson himself. I pointed to the man's hat and said, "It's a very nice hat, sir. I'd like to have a hat like that someday." To my astonishment, the man's mouth suddenly turned up in a huge grin. His eyes got all crinkled up, and his eyebrows and even his ears wiggled. It was something to see. Molly and I were right taken aback at first, but soon we were grinning too. Then, real abrupt, his face changed. It turned so cold and fearsome it took my breath away. His eyes got all squinty, looking right past us like we weren't even there in front of him. I tried to follow his eyes, over to the other side of the river. At first, all I saw was the forest and the river flowing by nice and peaceful. Then I noticed a flicker of movement and focused on a man slipping quick and sly through a stand of birch trees. I caught just a glimpse of a lean body, a large head with a strong, thick neck, and brown hair with what looked like a patch of white up front. Even as I watched, the figure vanished in the thin dawn light till I wasn't sure I had even seen it. I turned back to our companion and was relieved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.